put this on analyze. I'll let you see for yourself. It's actually, if anything, it's a little bit more than G. So let's say fit align, and let's say auto fit. And look at this number here. It says 1.03. This is E1. That means move it over one place. That's 10 point something. So the slope of that line indicates the acceleration. It's at least 9.8. It's actually a little over 10 according to this measurement. Okay? Now, with that in mind, with something so straightforward for somebody. Now, this is high school physics, guys. It's maybe not all of you had high school physics, but it's not like graduate level, it's not rocket science. It's something that a typical 11th or 12th grade student would be expected to be able to do on their own. Okay? Now, NIST's value for the fall of the building, the way they phrased it is it came down 40% slower than free fall. Now, in the first place, they didn't talk about acceleration. They talked about time. And they said the time it took to come down was 40% longer than free fall would have been. And so they're using sort of, in a sense, deceptive constructs to even talk about this. But what they're getting at is, hey, this is nowhere near free fall. And that's a problem. Okay?
So you're saying you're lying.
Oh, yeah, let's start with that. Okay, let's see what I'm saying. This part's going to be a little video, so I can rest my voice for a second here. And this is probably the video that, if I'm famous, this is the one that did it. But it's not me. Hey, I'm not the star of this show. Star of this show are these guys from NIST. You'll see what I mean. Now we'll see if these speakers are turned on.
In August 2008, after a seven-year delay, NIST, the government agency charged with investigating the World Trade Center collapses, released the draft of their final report on the collapse of World Trade Center Building 7 for public comment. In that report, they claimed that the time for the building to fall the first 18 stories, that's the part of the collapse visible on many videos, was 40% longer than it would have taken had it been in free fall. I responded with a video posted on YouTube called WTC7 in Freefall, in which I showed that for approximately 2.5 seconds, Building 7 fell at a rate indistinguishable from freefall. Furthermore, in that video, I showed that NIST's methodology was not a valid way to analyze the true motion of the building. NIST's measurement was not just wrong, it was fraudulent. Then on August 26th, NIST staged a technical briefing in which engineers and others with technical credentials could pose questions. I'm a high school physics teacher, so I figured I would be excluded. However, I went ahead and registered, citing my membership in the American Association of Physics Teachers as my professional affiliation. By the way, I am not speaking for AAPT. That was just my passport into the briefing. To my surprise, my credentials were accepted, and I was able to pose a question. Here's a little of how it went.
Our next question comes from David Chandler of the American Association of Physics Teachers. Any number of competent measurements using a variety of methods indicate the northwest corner of WTC7 fell with an acceleration within a few percent of the acceleration of gravity. Yet your report contradicts this, claiming 40% slower than free fall based on a single data point. How can such a publicly visible, easily measurable quantity be set aside?
Can you repeat the question, please?
Sure. Any number of measurements using a variety of methods indicate the northwest corner of WTC7 fell with an acceleration within a few percent of the acceleration of gravity. Yet the report contradicts this, claiming 40% slower than the free fall based on a single data point?
Well, first of all, gravity is the loading function that applies to the structure, applies to every body, all bodies on this planet, not just in ground zero.
Whoa. I'm used to responses like that on a physics exam when a student hasn't even bothered to open the book. This is NIST speaking, so let's continue.
The analysis showed there's a difference in time between a free fall time. A free fall time would be an object that has no structural components below it. And if you look at the analysis of the video, it shows that the time it takes for the 17, for the roof line of the video to collapse down the 17 floors that you can actually see in the video, below which you can't see anything in the video, is about 3.9 seconds. What the analysis shows, and the structural analysis shows, or the collapse analysis shows, it's that same time that it took for the structural model to come down from the roof line all the way for those 17 floors to disappear is 5.4 seconds. It's about 1.5 seconds, or roughly 40% more time for that free fall to happen. And that is not at all unusual, because there was a structural resistance that was provided in this particular case. And you had a sequence of structural failures that had to take place, and everything was not instantaneous.
Buried in all that verbiage, what Dr. Sundar is saying is, free fall for the 18 stories under consideration would have taken 3.9 seconds. However, their computer model simulating collapse required 5.4 seconds. The slower collapse time was to be expected, since there was structure supporting the building as it fell, slowing the fall. But there was a progression of failures that had to take place, and that these were not instantaneous. All of this makes sense as long as you don't look at the evidence. The evidence shows that free fall actually occurred. But since their computer modeling could not come up with a scenario that would allow for free fall, they had to declare free fall out of bounds and try to cover up the evidence. The problem is, unlike the columns and girders buried deep inside the building, the motion of the building is right out in plain view. Since their model predicted 5.4 seconds for the 18-story collapse, they dutifully conjured up a 5.4-second measurement to match. They had to stretch themselves to do it, but they did it. They found the disappearance time, then they went out of their way to pick an artificially early start time, exactly 5.4 seconds earlier. This they compared with free fall time.
This next question comes from Dr. Stephen Jones. This discusses the fall time for WTC-7 on page 40 of the summary report, where it stated, assuming that the descent speed was approximately constant. However, observations by others of the descent speed show that the building is accelerating rather than being at constant speed. So the question is, why did NIST assume that the descent speed was approximately constant?
Stephen Jones was calling attention to the obviously erroneous claim on page 40 of the draft report that stated that the building descended at constant speed. I'm sure constant speed was a simple misstatement. The correct response should have been, whoops, we'll fix that. But no, here's how they handled that question.
Force of gravity obviously is the acceleration of gravity is what's at the driving force, and our calculation was based on the amount of time from the top of the parapet to fall till it disappeared from view between the two buildings seen in the video. That time was established from the video by a single frame search of the time, so that was down to 1/30th of a second. And then we did the same thing for when the top of the parapet disappeared. We found that that time to be 5.4 seconds.
I didn't hear a whoops in there, did you? This is John Gross, one of the lead engineers for the NIST report on the collapse of the Twin Towers. He has a PhD in structural engineering from Cornell University. He taught engineering at the University of Colorado in Boulder. He has a long resume on top of that. Don't you think he probably knows the difference between speed and acceleration? Don't you think he could explain it with perfect clarity if he wasn't so preoccupied trying to cover his tracks? Don't you find it interesting that the 5.4 seconds he measured for the collapse time just happens to exactly match the theoretical prediction of their model? That kind of precision is incredibly rare when modeling real-world events. Incredible is the right word. It's not crazy.